leading the revolution of talk radio. Lynn Cullen.
Hey there, hello, and welcome back to One and All, Lynn Cullen, second hour, Tuesday, and that means we're joined by my kid sister, Susan. Hi, Susan. Hi, how are you?
I'm suffering through yet another beautiful day myself.
Yeah, you know, I'm thinking, we've had nothing but just perfect days lately, and I'm thinking, so this is what it's like to live in, what, Southern California or something?
Right, but it's like that here, too.
Wow.
Just amazing. It's totally beautiful.
Low humidity, beautiful sun, temperature's just right, all that. We'll pay.
I'm sure I'm about to lose power. I don't know how it works.
Yeah, something like that.
Right.
Okay, well.
Well, I was listening to you a little bit last hour, just trying to figure out where you're going, and the only reason I'm bringing this up again, and it's not going to go where you want with it, is that our largest conservative synagogue last week voted to perform same-sex marriage commitment ceremonies.
You're a conservative synagogue. Oh, wow.
Right.
Well, I wonder what Yitzchak would say about that.
Well, I don't know, but what was interesting was the way the newspaper ran the story twice, and it made me wonder whether they were trying to stir something up.
Oh.
You know, 2 days in a row.
And you think they were trying to, what, create controversy?
Why do that?
It's controversial enough.
And, you know, they just announced it. You know, if everybody's going to get away with it and no one's going to, you know, firebomb anything, that would be nice. I worry about these things. Social change is difficult on a community that has a section that doesn't want to change.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, Reform Judaism, I know my temple, I think, does commitment ceremonies, very welcoming to gay people. And but for the Orthodox, forget about it.
Well, you know, and my synagogue is much the same. I mean, I think the only rule at my synagogue is that the president of it has to be Jewish.
Well, that would seem to make some sense.
Right.
Didn't the, I think, like, the president of the synagogue in Green Bay a few years back was named Christensen?
Well, exactly.
But he was Jewish.
Well, he was Jewish.
But his name was Christensen.
He had converted, but there are a surprising number of non-Jews who are married to Jews who become very active in our synagogue, mm-hmm. and they felt that they had to make a rule that said, okay, well, if you really want to be that committed, you ought to convert.
Yeah. Okay.
I guess that's where they were coming from.
Okay. Here's my favorite clipping of the day. This is from Reuters.
Yeah.
A Chinese court has jailed two officials after they let a blind contractor build a bridge, which collapsed during construction and injured 12. Well, you gotta love stories like that.
You really do.
Yeah.
You really, I don't know. So what was in it for them, one might ask?
I can't imagine. Whatever. They were in charge of road management and supervision. They did not... Well, I guess they didn't even check to see whether the guy could see. They just, you know, they...
They just got their money and didn't care what was happening.
No, but it says here that when they knew the bridge was being built by a blind contractor, they did not stop it.
Well, he had to have some sighted help, didn't he?
Well, in fact, it says the blind contractor changed the blueprint.
But how did he know?
Well, don't ask me. I don't know. Anyway, the guys, they sentenced these guys to jail for not stopping the project.
Well, I feel safer.
Yeah.
And I'll remember, actually, my nephew's in China, so I'll have to warn him to avoid the bridge.
Well, it's already down. It collapsed.
Oh, good.
Yeah, so it's not there.
Right.
Okay.
Right. So I went to my 450th wedding.
Yeah, you have been doing a lot of weddings.
Oh, jeez.
Yike.
Every Friday now, it's a prenuptial dinner, and every Saturday, it's a wedding.
Gosh.
Yeah.
Okay, so...
No, this was a good one.
Mm-hmm.
This was my sister-in-law, who was marrying for the second time, and it was very nice to
Which
see.
One's this?
Huh?
Who?
Vicky.
Vicky. Okay.
Yes. Vicky has been divorced for several years and is leading a very successful life and met a very nice man.
Now, wait a minute. How old is married. Wait, how old is Vicky?
Vicky is my husband's older sister, so she's...
50.
She's about to be 59.
And she found a guy?
Yeah.
Jeez. How the heck she do that?
A nice one.
He's not a terrorist?
He's not a terrorist. He's a nice man. They share common values. They they really love each other. They have, you know, several children and grandchildren. No grandchildren on Vicky's side, but on David's side, they're grandchildren. They're the same age. It's really very nice.
Well, I'm very happy for her.
It was very, very, very nice. But I brought this up only to say that, as usual, I can't go anywhere with running into Pittsburghers.
Oh, they're everywhere. They're all fleeing the city. That's why you keep bumping into them.
I guess.
Well,
Lou will be jealous to know that I ran into a couple of Pittsburghers. One of Vicky's best friends is a woman named Betsy Walsh, and she lives in Pittsburgh. And as my husband said, she was the funny, smart one. I would add beautiful, but she's funny and smart, and she hasn't ever listened to you.
She's never listened to me?
No, but she said, but my husband watches her on TV, which makes absolutely no sense to me at all. I mean, why you would, you know, she was...
Well, is she going to listen to me, Betsy?
Well, maybe. I said I'd mention her name. You see, I just did. So if she's listening, then... And then there's her husband, who is an attorney in the largest law firm in Pittsburgh. His name is Mike Lyons. But anyway, he does listen to you, has for years and years and years and years, but he's a conservative.
Oh.
His big complaint with you, dear Lynn, is that you won't admit that you hate George Bush.
Oh, for God's
sake. And I said, well, why do you care? And he said, because I hate George Bush. Why shouldn't she hate George Bush?
I don't hate him. I don't think I do.
I tried to explain.
I don't think I do. I never hated, I can't, because I'm such a liberal. I see the humanity in just about everybody, and I sometimes actually, and I know this makes my audience nuts, I sometimes...
find yourself liking the poor kid.
Well, I got a kick out of something he said in Bulgaria the other day, and I laughed at it, and I also see him as a flawed human being, for God's sake, who's done terrible damage, I don't hate him. I hate what he's done. I don't hate him. If I did, I would admit it. I'll tell you who I hate. I have no problem. Well, even then, the one I think I hate is Cheney.
Yeah, it's pretty hard to find anything likable about him.
Well, the only time you like Cheney is when you see him with his family, how much he loves his children and grandchildren, and that humanizes him. But then, of course, you know, mass murderers seem nice around their children.
Well, right. I mean, you know, a whole nation fell in love with Tony Soprano.
That's what I was just thinking. Tony Soprano. I mean, look, he loves his children.
So he offed a few people. He's such a nice family.
Yeah,
guy.
I know. But see, but it shows the complexity.
See,
of.
But I don't feel that way about Cheney. I don't, because to me, Cheney is the ultimate in hypocrisy. That applies totally different standards to how he would run his own family privately and how he would have the country run, you know, publicly. And I just be loving to your family. Translate that to the country. Don't turn around and act differently.
Yeah. Well, that's true.
What you find excuses him, in my eyes, makes him worse.
Just condemns him more.
Right.
All right.
But anyway, that was that. And the only other comment was that he was totally shocked that you got away with telling people to drop dead.
What do you mean?
He says that you frequently, just after cutting someone off, say, drop dead.
Wait a minute. Matt, how often have you heard me tell someone to drop dead? Seriously. Matt's in there with a quizzical. Now, Matt hears every word I say. How many times have you heard me tell someone to drop dead?
Not very often. I mean, I can't think of any specific instance. I can think where maybe you might have said
hear the
that
words.
After a
I
caller.
I can imagine the words coming out
yeah,
of your
I can
mouth.
Imagine the words coming out. I can't think of a specific instance. Maybe after a caller really went off or something and you got really irate and hung up.
Right.
But I can't sit here and say, well, gee, that happens like 5 times a show or anything crazy like that.
No,
well,
no.
I think mostly he's curious about what the person has said that's made you that angry.
Well, if I get that angry, it is, yeah, I'm pretty angry if I say drop dead.
Well, and what I said is I don't think you can even begin to imagine the kind of stuff that people will say.
Well, so anyway, so okay, so you were with
that's these... that, but I also pointed out to him that he's been listening to you for 20 years. So...
Well, he can't listen much if he thinks I'm... I mean, that's ridiculous. And if he's in a law firm, he must be... Isn't he doing some
work? Yeah, he's watching your...
Oh, the 6 o'clock thing.
Right.
Oh, well, okay, well... If you ever see him again, tell him...
Well, I liked him very much. I liked both of them very much. It was fun to spend
okay.
time with
all right.
him.
Okay.
But anyway, so that was this wedding.
Mm-hmm. I haven't been to a wedding in ages. Nobody invites me anywhere. I have not been to a wedding in ages. Do you know the number of things I have never done is just amazing? I mean, I guess I'm not a very, I'm not a social person.
Well, like, what else haven't you ever done?
Well, it's not a matter of ever, but let me tell you, I've only been to no bridal showers, one bridal shower, and 2 baby showers in my life.
Well, may I say that you are extremely fortunate?
Oh, you bet! I know I am. I'll never forget the first baby shower I went to. I was humiliated. The second one, I had more of a sense of what goes on.
What did you bring the first time?
Well, I don't know, like a pair of booties or something. I don't know. Nothing.
You didn't bring a stroller?
No! And I mean, there's some woman I worked with. And when they started opening gifts, and I saw people who I knew made like minimum wage in the newsroom were, bringing in baby strollers or something. I thought, you gotta be kidding me.
Well, it's really,
I got a onesie or something. What kind of nonsense is that?
Weddings and babies have been turned into a real business.
God.
You know, I mean, on the part of the people, jackpot, I get to extract expensive gifts several times. It's when, in my family, you know, there's so many people that you get invited to multiple things for the same person.
I know.
I've gotten to the point where I smile at people and I say, you're going to get one very nice present.
That's right, one. I mean, you hit them up. It's just unbelievable to me. It's disgusting. Did you have any baby showers? I bet you did.
I think my mother-in-law had one, and it was mostly my sisters-in-law. You know, it was...
Well, you know what happened? Come to think of it, I had one. But it was a surprise baby shower, and it was awfully sweet. It was thrown by the folks at WTAE-TV, just a few months before I got Sam.
Well, it's fun to be the person that gets all this stuff.
Yeah, but I mean, I didn't know anything about it, and I think I would have put the kibosh on it if I did. But
well, I feel the same way. I mean, there's a wedding coming up in my family next spring, and I already have women friends here saying, "Let me throw a shower, wouldn't you?" And I'm going, and I've done these things for them at their, sort of at their request. What can I do for you? And they want to do it for me, but I don't like approve.
No.
But it's really not for me to say. I'll ask my future daughter-in-law if she'd like to have a shower.
But it's like, the young couple now begins shaking down friends and acquaintances.
Shaking down family and friends. It's just really...
I don't like it.
I don't like it.
Well,
and I don't think
you.
It's the emphasis on the right syllable anyway.
Right. I don't get it.
You know, this is all about, we take all of these things that are supposed to be personal and important and meaningful and...
We commodify them.
We commodify them. We make them about things.
And you know what else that does? And then people start one-upping the other.
Money.
The stress it puts on people. I mean, I find that, people are so stressed around weddings and things because they become productions. Well, whatever happened to just, you know, the point of it all? It has nothing to do with any of that. I just don't get it.
I don't get it either. And I don't get spending more, you know, spending the down payment on an extremely nice house.
Right, right. Not to mention when you're still paying off student loans,
right,
and all of that. What is the point?
Wouldn't a priest, minister, rabbi, or justice of the peace and a check do better? Pay off the student loan.
Well, you and I are on the same page here. See, Susan,
but, you know, you and I both opted to get married.
We got married in the backyard.
In our backyards, and neither one of us even wore a official wedding dress because I got grumpy when I saw what those cost.
I didn't know. I know we both got... You copied me.
Well, you make good decisions.
I got married in the backyard, not wearing a wedding dress, on a beautiful...
Although yours looked more like a wedding dress than mine did.
Yeah, this is true. And we... and then everybody ate in the house.
Or in the backyard.
And then everybody went home.
Mm-hmm.
And then I honeymooned in a flying festive...
And mother literally cooked the meal.
Yeah. So
tenderloin.
Ooh, is that good?
Right.
Okay, so somebody was saying, you know, I don't even remember having a wedding cake. Did I have a wedding
cake? Yeah, you had a wedding cake, and I did, too.
Did you?
A small little wedding cake.
Oh, okay. Well, anyway, that's how we do it up in Green Bay, Wisconsin.
And they were beautiful weddings.
They were lovely weddings.
You know, I mean...
And Susan's took.
And mine took. After I promised Uncle Sam that I would never do what you had done.
And you did.
I married a German Catholic. You married an Irish Catholic. I did not.
But he meant Catholic.
Well, the promise was not specific.
He wanted you to marry a Jew.
Sorry, I did it right.
All right, well, anyway, and our brother did us one better. He eloped.
And married an Irish Catholic.
No, a German Catholic.
Oh, right, a German Catholic.
Yeah. Who converted.
Right.
All right, I'm out of here. I got to get a break in here, Suze.
Okay.
We'll be right back. I don't know what we're talking about. We're taking a break.
We are.
Thank
not-
God. No, I need it.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I'm Lynn Cullen, along with her kid sister, Susan, and it's AM News Talk 1360. We are back. That would be Susan and me. Susan,
yeah.
Just to counter your little story about bumping into some Pittsburghers in St. Louis, I was at a garden party and met a woman who graduated from UWGB, that's the University of Wisconsin Green Bay, and then ended up in Creve Coeur.
Wow.
And she said she listens to us and feels very much at home. So there you have it.
They forgot the accent, the location. Well, that's nice.
No, she said she could never do the accent. Like she added a little bit.
Well, you never, you don't hear it in yourself when
no,
you get
that's
it.
True.
But
that's
that
true.
Nasal creeps it. My daughter has it, and she's gotten it from me.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Isn't that awful?
Yeah, that's awful. I don't think she has it.
Well, every once in a while, I hear Noel.
Well, hey, say hello to Sissy White Liberal. Go ahead.
Hey, good morning, ladies.
Hi.
Morning.
Yeah, about baby showers, I have a kind of a thing that I like to do. Now, I don't get to go to them because I'm a man. They don't want me there. But,
lucky you.
Which doesn't bother me a whole lot. But what I like to do, it seems like a lot of my relatives live by Philadelphia, and they don't have a Gabe's out that way. Do you know what Gabe's is, Lynn?
Yeah.
Yeah. You can spend $125 on baby stuff at Gabe's and pretty much outfit a child for about 2 years on that.
Yeah.
And I get kind of a kick out of doing that. I did it for my brother's baby, and then my oldest niece just had a child not too long ago. And if you spend as much money as maybe for like three of those little designer outfits,
mm-hmm.
you can clothe a child for 2 whole years that way. I think that's kind of a cool thing. You know, they get this great big box. It's like, you know, Christmas, you know, regardless of what time of year it is.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, it's kind of a cool thing. And the other thing about Itzhak is I have the same attitude that you have, Lynn, in that talk radio to me is an interesting medium where you can hear differing points of views on things. And I don't not like to hear from people that I don't agree with. I mean, maybe they might make me think of something I hadn't thought of.
Oh, right. As a matter of fact, nothing is more boring than a show
right.
in which all, you know, true believers, you know, talk to each other.
Right.
I hate it.
Well,
it's
actually what's wrong with what goes on right now. You can't grow and expand if you only listen to people that agree with you.
Right. But, I mean, in Itzhak's case, we know what he's going to say before he opens his mouth. Consult the manual. Consult the manual. Read the Bible. What does the Bible say? And the interesting thing there, in my opinion, is that I'm sure that the Muslims who are killing everybody in the Middle East feel exactly the same way that he does.
Absolutely.
From their perspective of their Bible.
Right.
As do fundamentalist Christians that are responsible and Muslims in Kosovo and Bosnia. So all this fundamentalism that he thinks is just so wonderful, you know, I wish they'd start an island nation somewhere and just leave the rest of us alone, you know. But we don't really need to hear from Itzhak. We know what he's going to say before he opens his mouth. There's nothing interesting there. We know what's going to come out. So I would just submit that his calls are a waste of time, from my perspective.
They are redundant, you're saying.
Absolutely.
Heard one, heard them all.
That's right.
Thank you very much.
Take care, ladies.
Bye. I don't know if you heard Yitzchak, Susan. Oh, I knocked Susan off. Well, dang it. Okay. We'll get her back. Meanwhile, let me talk to John and Irwin. Hi, John.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Glenn. Hi. I almost called on this last week when you were talking about the language of sex in American attitudes toward language and, you know, euphemisms and all that stuff. But I didn't have time to call because I had too many appointments. But this is kind of just an amusing story. I was listening to Dr. Laura, and this guy called in. And you could tell he wanted...
Can I put you on hold while I get Susan back on? And then
sure,
we'll come right
yeah.
back to you. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. I'm hoping I'm going to do this right. Hang on.
Okay.
Hang on. All right. Susan? No.
I'm here.
Oh, you are?
That was me.
I consider that Matt's fault.
He copped to it immediately when I said
he
hung up on me.
You weren't on your usual line, and I didn't notice that. Okay, now we're just about to hear a story from John, okay?
Okay.
Hang in here. Now, John, go ahead.
You were talking about the young man who got sent to jail for 10 years.
Yeah.
I think I saw that story on 2020 or one of those, and I think he's black and the girl was white. If it's the same story.
Was the girl white? I didn't know that.
I think so. I'm pretty sure it's the same story.
I don't know. I don't know if they've actually mentioned her because she's 15. I don't think they've put out one way or the other because they would keep that confidential just for age.
I think the 2020 story or 60 Minutes or whatever brought that out, if it's the same case. But anyway, this is just a funny thing that has to do with all these, you know, this society's attitudes towards sex and euphemisms about it and all that stuff. I was listening to Dr. Laura a few years ago, and this guy called in, and you could tell he wanted praise for his attitude. And he said that he and his wife wanted to be good parents and bring their kids up properly. And so they taught the little boy, who was about 6 now, to call his penis a dinky. And they taught the little girl to call hers the tinkle box.
Oh, God almighty.
And then he was very proud that when they asked their first questions about sex, they were able to tell the boy and the girl that the way babies were made was whenever the father put his dinky in the mother's tinkle box. I just thought... and then I didn't know what Dr. Law was going to say about all this, but she was just appalled, just really laid into him. And, you know, and then he was taken aback because he expected
praise.
To be told how
well,
great
did
they
were. She told him to use the correct words.
Yeah. She said, "What in the world is wrong with penis and vagina?" You know? And she just laid into him. Anyway, I thought... I wanted to cheer you up with this story, well, and I didn't get a chance to call before.
Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I'm
That's
appreciative.
It.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Well, and now, of course, the puns are just floating through my mind. But anyway, I'm just going to suggest that the psychological damage done to the little boy alone is actionable.
Well, you know, and I have told this, I think, before, in our family.
Yeah, we couldn't say pee.
We couldn't say pee. It was the same thing. Because pee, if you think about it, is short for...
Can we say that word?
I don't know. Can we say that word on the air? What P is short for? Do you know what it's short for?
Well, I know what it's short for.
What?
Piss.
Well, I know.
I guess we can say it.
Well, you just did.
But we couldn't say that.
We could not say
because
P because it was
word.
Short for a word that my parents thought was not proper. And so we were the only kids... ever in the history of the universe, who didn't say P for urine, we said...
D. Which stood for P. But, you know, it's another...
We said D, which stood for P, which, yeah.
You say it this time. We can make a whole song out of it.
Yeah, well, God almighty, what nonsense.
It was total nonsense.
All right. Well... Hey,
and mom is so smart. I never figured that one out.
Well, you know, it was just something you didn't... I don't know how you know that came from mom. It might have come from dad.
I doubt it.
Well, I'll tell you what. I got to take my mid-break because it's way past my mid-break.
Okay.
And we'll be right back.
Okay.
Hang in. And here we are, back again with Susan. Susan, here's Miles. Hiya, Miles.
Don't take the dollar coins, do you?
Yeah.
Hello. Miles.
Hi.
Hi.
Hey, Lynn. I'm glad to be on, and I got my story. I just wanted to let you and your sister know that when I hear you doing that accent, it always reminds me of the mother on Bobby's World.
Bobby's World. What? I don't even know that show.
It was a cartoon.
Oh, you know what? I know that voice, and that woman does a lot of cartoon mother voices, it seems, because you're right. There is a voice I'm hearing all the time on those animated shows, and the mom sounds like this.
Yes, exactly.
Right? I wonder who that is.
Yeah, I don't know the name of the voice actress for that.
You're right. I hear that, too, and I think it's more than on that show. Or maybe that is what the show is. Is it on Cartoon Network or Comedy Central?
It's an old one. I haven't seen it for
years.
But anyway, so I heard you talking about whether circus weddings and baby showers and bridal showers have become.
Yeah.
And that reminded me back in the old days when my wife and I got married. And basically, her parents took care of everything. And we had this. We were very laid back, and we weren't that much invested in the whole affair. But we did have to make some decisions, and so we got involved in the menu for the wedding, the reception afterwards. So we're making decisions: what entree, what this, what that. And one of the things we had to decide on was dessert. Now there was this huge, like Viennese dessert table. And on top of that, then the caterer started talking to us about wedding cake. So we said, well, we got this huge dessert table. What do we need a wedding cake for?
Right.
So, well, you need it because what about when you see the photos afterwards? How will you know that it's a wedding if you don't have that wedding cake there?
Oh, for God's sake.
And then he said, well... we said about the dessert table, he said, well, you can get a plastic cake. It'll be decorated. It'll look just like a wedding cake. And we said, no, thank you. So somehow, when we look at our wedding pictures, we know it's not a bar mitzvah. It's really a wedding. I think it's that white dress gives it away every time.
Well, you took away one of the most expensive items. That's a high markup item.
The cake.
Oh, well.
Oh, well, are you sure you're really married if you didn't have a wedding cake? I wonder. So how long ago was that?
28 years this August.
Very good, Miles. Keep it up.
Thank you.
Thank
and,
you.
You keep up your good work.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Right. I'm 31 this August.
Are you, Suze?
Right.
Wow.
Amazing.
Oh, I'd be 35 if I hung on there, I think.
Well, yeah, I think you would.
Or at least.
But you didn't.
No, I didn't. Too bad.
That's okay. Sometimes it takes. Sometimes it doesn't.
Sometimes it doesn't. Anyway, well, speaking of wedding cakes, oh, let's not.
No, let's not. What?
No, I was just thinking of Barbara and Ned's wedding.
Well, now you got to tell them. Our all-time favorite, you had to be there with us under the table.
Actually, I just saw a video somewhere on TV or on the internet that was reminiscent of that wedding. This is a wedding. Susan and I were both bridesmaids. Is that the one you passed out at?
I passed out at Barbara's wedding. I was 13 and my knees were locked.
Well, that's what I was saying, 13. Right. We wore those blue dresses.
Those blue dresses and those awful veils and ugh.
And there were like 20,000 bridesmaids, and Susan passed out in the middle.
I was
of
out of the room when Uncle Sam gave the lecture about not locking your knees because you'll pass out.
Oh, you didn't hear that?
No.
Well,
I think I was having my makeup done or something, or my hair ratted.
So this is a wedding a long time ago. Susan was how old? Do you
I
think?
Was 13.
13. Okay, I was then 16 or so, and I was the maid of honor.
Right. And I had braces.
And you had braces. And this was in the Beverly Hills Hotel ballroom. And it was a wedding that had it was huge. Just huge.
Right.
And the wedding cake, as I recall, was huge.
Right. Oh, it was the wedding cake, I think, it came out on a table, and it had to be at least 5 feet tall.
Oh, at least.
I mean, off the table, don't you think?
Oh, easily.
Right, 5 or 6 feet tall.
Yeah,
right.
But, you know, granted, I mean, this was many, many, many years ago, and so maybe we're not remembering it quite right, but I think we are.
No, I think that's correct.
And all I remember is when they cut into the cake, doves flew out of it. Right? Is that what happened?
Well, there were drawers built
underneath
into the cake, and they opened the drawers.
And it appeared that as soon as bang, doves came out and start flying around this ballroom and doing what birds have been caged.
And doing what birds who have been locked in a cake for, you know, 5 hours do. So I was under the table. I don't know about you.
Lots of women were screaming. It was a riot.
And then they repeated it for each of the daughters.
And then their two daughters, when they married, they had doves. Doves came into the picture. I don't know that they flew
doves,
out of the
There were
cake.
Doves at the ceremony, but the same thing happened. At
well, that's what
two,
happens
at
with
least
the...
two guests were decorated.
Well, I just saw a video where they released doves around the cake, and this bird immediately did its job right on the cake, which was very funny.
You think they get a refund for that?
I don't know.
The bride's mother said, I'll take that piece.
that's right. Oh, no, that's mine. That's okay. I want it. I really do. I want it. There's something about a drizzle of pigeon
poop. It's nothing.
Poop.
It's nothing. We can just scrape that off.
Yes, that's right. It's good. It's fine. Ron and Larimer, hi.
Hi, Lynn.
Hi.
Back to the story about euphemisms for your privates.
Okay.
My mother, and I guess my father, but I think this was more my mother, called mine my worm.
Oh, my God.
Now, can you imagine what problem that caused in later life?
I would think.
Well, when I got to be a teenager, my friends and I started going skinny dipping. And it was okay, I could do that if it was in a swimming pool. But I couldn't go skinny dipping in a river or lake.
Oh, come on, because you thought there was a fish would...
I was afraid. That got planted in my head. And I was afraid of fish. I was afraid to go naked in anything that had fish in it. But swimming pools were fine. So isn't that weird how something that just gets subtly put in your head like that,
yeah,
you know, can really affect you in later life? And when I was in probably my 30s, I took a canoe trip up to Canada, up in Canada. And have you ever seen a sturgeon?
They're huge.
Oh, my God. They're like 6-8 foot long.
Right,
and they would swim. We'd be going down through a little rapids, and there'd be one of those coming the other way. And it was like the size of the canoe almost. And I was just, oh, my God. And there was no, this was a wilderness trip, and you had to bathe in the river. And what I didn't know about them is they're like catfish. You know, they have a mouth like a sucker, and they're bottom feeders. They're not predatory at all. But you can imagine the terror.
Oh, jeez. Well, they could have taken you whole. They don't need, my God. Oh, well, I'm sorry, Ron. And how many psychiatric visits did that require?
Yeah, a good psychoanalyst can help you with this.
I would think so.
Thanks a lot,
yeah,
guys.
Thank you. Because sometimes a worm is just a worm. God. Carolyn.
Well, I'm telling you, the psychic damage that
I know, people do. Carolyn, hello.
Hi. Hi, ladies. Two things. The first one is Susan was telling how horrified she was and how she refused to address her own self-envelope for her thank you note that was going to be, and how, you know, that awful that was. And now there's a commercial on television. I think it's for mailboxes, but it's something akin to that. And now they're telling you how easy it is to email your thank yous, which I think is very gauche.
Oh, I do too.
And I mean, they come right out and say, you know, why, it's a breeze, and you don't have to do all those awful thank yous and so forth, and you just email all your thank yous.
Nope.
No, you don't.
Not for the kind of money they're extorting out of me for my wedding presents. I want a handwritten note, and I don't want it to say, "Dear Susan and Eric, thank you for the blank."
And somewhat in prompt fashion, also. I don't want it to...
5 years later.
So long that I can't remember what gift I gave, practically.
Right.
Also, since both of you ladies drive a Lexus...
I have in my past.
Oh, are you
at
not
the moment,
anymore?
She is not, no.
Okay, she's reformed, huh?
No. But she... whatever. Susan.
Well, anyway, was Meadow trying to park a self-parking Lexus the other night?
I don't think that was a
joke. I think the joke was, I was irritated because the joke was that she's a girl, so of course she can't parallel park.
Right, but someone said it was excoriated because it was the Lexus that you're supposed to be able to self-park.
Oh, but that I don't know. Boy,
okay.
Some people watch TV with such... with.
I know,
horoscopes.
And I couldn't define that, so I thought maybe one of you could answer that.
No, I don't know.
Okay.
But... you know, there are people that, there was nothing else in that final show to watch, so I guess they were looking for tickets, for you know, something to notice about this stuff.
Yeah.
Well, you had to know the song that he chose also to bring you to full fashion.
What, the Journey song?
Yeah, I mean, that supposedly had some significance that he chose that song.
Isn't that the song that Bill Clinton used on his campaign?
Yeah.
All the time?
Yes, it is.
Don't stop thinking about tomorrow. Okay. Don't ask me. I don't know. Carolyn, thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Oh, boy.
Well, I don't know. Did you watch that final thing? I didn't even watch the whole season, but I thought, well, I better watch this one.
No, I watched the whole season. I'd never watched any Sopranos, but then I did watch the whole season, and... I don't know. I was a little bit of a...
I know. Well, you know, the only conversation at our house was... that after all these years, you know, the American Psychoanalytic Association gave Dr. Malfi an award for representing psychoanalysis so well, you know, showing exactly how it was done until the show before last when she fired Tony.
Oh, it was awful.
Eric said, get that award back.
And all those analysts sitting around talking.
And her supervisor outed her. I mean, she should have fired her supervisor, not the patient.
Yeah, it was badly bad. I agree. It
just
made no sense.
And for them to do so well up until that point, it was just... So I want to tell everybody out there, that wasn't right.
No, it was outrageous.
That part wouldn't happen, wasn't right.
A psychoanalyst would never do that.
The supervisor would have been fired. The supervisor would have been reprimanded.
Yeah, so...
No right to say anything. No right to out a patient. Ever, ever, ever.
That's what I thought.
So, you know, little things that we have to straighten out.
I think I have another break. I do.
Okay.
Hang in there, Suze.
I'm here.
Okay, I'll be right back. All right, here we are back with Susan. Just a few minutes in which to do that. Susan, Sissy White Liberal emailed and said, "Don't Stop" is a Fleetwood Mac song.
Yeah. The Journey song was...
What was the Journey song he played?
Well, now I'm confused, but it wasn't that song. It was it's Don't Stop Believing, but I can't...
Oh. Well, that's... Isn't that different?
Yeah, that's...
Don't Stop...
Believing.
Is that it? The only thing worse than me singing
is
the two of us singing.
I can't do it. I had it in my head until you started.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, yeah, you're right. When it comes to music and popular music, I am as clueless a person as ever existed.
Right.
Right.
Me too.
Well, I don't know that you're as bad as me. Really pretty bad. So I think that's it. You got anything else?
Well, I don't. No.
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 I think you said no.
I probably did. I'm just pleased that we made it. That we haven't discussed. No, I'm not even going to say it.
Iraq. Iraq.
No one's discussing Iraq. I mean, for heaven's sakes, that seems to be important.
Oh. So, what, Gonzalez?
I'm just amazed at what I have been watching on the news for the last, week and a half, and what headline stories are and stuff. And
oh, you mean with Paris Hilton? That's what I'm thinking. Well, you know, even the New York Times had a front page story.
Yeah, I know.
Well.
I give up.
The culture is just coming apart. We're dumbing down so fast, it's unbelievable. So...
Well, I guess. It's pretty horrifying. But anyway, I was in a good mood because it was a beautiful day.
I still am. I refuse to not be in a good mood, I think.
Okay.
Maybe, sort of, kind of.
Okay.
It is. It's a beautiful day. How can you be in a bad mood?
Well, it's probably pretty possible.
Well, the thing is, as I said, if you make your living having to talk about the news of the day, and the news of the day is uniformly horrific, it
can be depressing. But
I guess so.
Then, for all you out there who are worried about that, remember that laughing does release endorphins and makes you happy, and your brain doesn't know whether it's real laughter or fake laughter. So if you're really bummed, just sit around and go, ha, 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 ha.
Is that
ha,
true? Your
eventually,
brain?
You'll release endorphins and start to feel better.
Oh, that's what that laugh therapy is.
Right.
So you're saying...
And it works. They've shown that it does...
So
your brain doesn't know the difference between your pretending and your not pretending.
Oh, cool.
And your real laughter.
So you hoodwink yourself.
Right.
That's a good idea. Okay, Susan, we'll all laugh hysterically in just one
moment.
Well, I think
that's why I'm such a happy person, because I laugh, which makes me happier, which makes me laugh, which makes me happier.
I laugh a lot, too, I think.
Right.
Okay, Suze, thank you.
You're welcome.
Keep laughing, and I'll talk at you again next week.
I could talk about anything for a minute. Bye.
Bye. Kid sister Susan. Ha, 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 ha. Laugh. Your brain doesn't know you're not really laughing. Here's some news. We'll be back on the other side.